the name and then the second third are the Chinese name.
Introduce the last speaker for today's session. It's Professor Ronald Lok from the University of China. He's going to talk about 3D mapping tempo.
So first of all, I'd like to thank the organizer, Raymond, for the invitations and give me a chance to come back here to give a talk. I actually did my postdoc here. So the title of my talk today is Tempo, Feature-endowed Teichmuller extremal mapping of point cloud. So in this work, we're interested in a special class of mapping called Teichmuller mapping, or T-map, that minimizes or optimizes conformality distortions. So this is a joint work with a number of people. Gary and Ting Wei are my graduate student. David Gu from Stony Brook University is my long-time collaborator. Professor Xing Tong Yao was my supervisor when I did my postdoc here at Harvard University. So before I talk about my work, since it is recording, so let me say a few words about the work of Professor Yao in image processing. So actually, most of us know Professor Yao has done a lot of work in pure mathematics, in particular differential geometry. But actually, Professor Yao has also done a lot of work on image processing. So for example, one of the work that Professor Yao and his collaborator has been doing is the development of a 3D camera. So using the very advanced differential geometry technique together with the dual camera system, so Professor Yao is able to create a 3D camera with very good accuracy. This is basically the dual camera system with the structural light system, and then this is his 3D camera, which can capture the 3D face very accurately. So besides, Professor Yao has also done quite a lot of work in medical image processing. So in particular, he is quite interested in exploring the possibility to apply his expertise of conformal or quasi-conformal geometry in medical imaging for different applications. For example, geometry processing. So given a brain cortical surface, you want to process the data, surface registration together with shape analysis for disease analysis. So for example, this is one of the examples. So for applying conformal in medical imaging. So using conformal punctuation technique, Professor Yao and his collaborators is able to transform a very complicated brain surface into some simple domain, for example, the Euler sphere or the 2D rectangle, such that computation can be done on the simple domain instead of the complicated brain cortical surface. So another application is applying quasi-conformal mapping to compute the surface registration between different anatomical structures. So for example, this is one of the examples to transform one brain to another brain, such that you have a one-to-one correspondence between two brain surfaces. So that with this one-to-one correspondence, then we can do some shape analysis to do some shape comparison between different anatomical structures. And using differential geometry, for example, by comparing the curvatures and barotomic coefficients and things, Professor Yao and his collaborator is able to compare different brain cortical surfaces to analyze the shape differences between healthy subject and unhealthy subject. So I guess this is the shape analysis of a brain cortical surface of a patient suffering from the Williams syndrome disease. And he also applied some algorithm, differential geometry algorithm, to analyze the temporal shape changes for Alzheimer's disease patients. So these are some of the work Professor Yao has done in image processing. So I guess this is actually one of the reasons he co-organized this workshop. So I just want to mention that, give you a feeling that Professor Yao has been doing a number of image processing work, not just pure mathematics. Okay, so let's come back to my topics. So today in my talk, I'm going to talk about also quasi-conformal, but I'm trying to formulate quasi-conformality on point cloud and trying to compute a T-map on point cloud. So this is the outline of my talk today. So first of all, I will talk about the motivation of this work. Then I'm going to talk about some basic mathematical background. So this work is related to quasi-conformal. So I will say a few words about what quasi-conformal geometry is. Then I'm going to talk about how we can formulate quasi-conformal on point cloud, because we are going to work on point cloud, so we want to formulate the ideas of QC on point cloud. And then the most important part of this talk is how we can compute a type of mapping called Teichmuller mapping, which minimizes the conformality distortion on point cloud. And then I'm going to show some applications of T-map. Okay, so first of all, what is the motivations? So the motivation of this work is to deal with point cloud. Okay, so basically, what is point cloud? A point cloud is just a collection of coordinate, x, y, z coordinate, possibly with normals. So it's, in simple words, it's just a collection of points without any connectivity information. So if you have triangulation mesh, you have some connectivity information. You have some angle structures, which allows us to define conformalities. But for point cloud, we don't have any connectivity information. But it is the simplest representation of 3D geometric objects. It turns out that a lot of 3D scanning machine produces point cloud. For example, this is the famous, the very popular Kinect 3D scanning system. Output is point cloud. So, and this one is a very popular little toy, which is quite popular recently. So basically, it's quite cheap. So you just need to, so what you need to do is, if you want to scan a 3D geometric object, you just put the geometric objects on the round table, and as the round table rotates, then this camera actually capture these geometric objects, and the output is actually the point cloud. So what I want to say is that most 3D devices produce point cloud, and then you see that point cloud has been a very, very common representation and has been widespread in a lot of industrial applications. Well, although point cloud is the simplest type of representations for 3D geometric objects, the PC point cloud sampling of 3D geometric shapes is sometimes insufficient for many applications. For example, once you capture the 3D geometric object, there may be a lot of outlier points, and then you have to do some processing in order to make the point cloud to be useful for practical applications. So a lot of point cloud processing procedure has to be done in order to use the point cloud. So some common point cloud processing tasks include, for example, as I mentioned, outlier removal, smoothing of the point cloud, normal estimation. If you want to, for example, estimate the curvature on the point cloud, you have to estimate the normal estimations. Point cloud mapping or alignment, in order to compare two point cloud, do shape analysis of the point cloud, you have to do point cloud mapping and alignment. And shape reconstructions. Given a point cloud, you may want to build a triangulation mesh on the point cloud, or you want to build an intrinsic representation of point cloud, for example, the level set representation of the point cloud. So in this work, I'm going to focus on this point cloud processing application, point cloud mapping and alignment problems. So what is the point cloud mapping problem? So in simple words, point cloud mapping problem aims to find a transformations from one point cloud to another. So this is the with least least geometric distortion. So this is the ideas of point cloud mapping problems. So point cloud mapping problem can mainly be divided into two categories. One is the point cloud parameterization problems. So given the point cloud, you want to deform the point cloud onto some simple domain. For example, you have a point cloud here. You want to deform it to the Euler sphere on a simple domain, such that if you want to do the processing on this point cloud, you can actually do the processing on this domain. Okay, so this is point cloud parameterizations. And then another category of point cloud mapping problem is the point cloud registration problems. So we want to find meaningful one-to-one correspondence between two point clouds. So once you have a correspondence between two point clouds, then you can compare different point clouds. So that is another category of mapping problems. So it has quite a lot of applications. For example, if you want to do facial recognition, then you have to find registration between two point clouds. If you want to classify two different point clouds, you may need to find a mapping between them, and then you can use some existing shape analysis algorithm. For example, the tensor-based morphometry to do some shape analysis. And then you can also do some simplification. You can actually simplify the point cloud processing by doing point cloud parameterization. For example, if you want to do the meshing of this of this point cloud, you can actually build the DeLonghi triangulation on this simple mesh, and then interpolate it back to the original surface, and then you can do the mesh. So these are some of the applications of point cloud mapping problems. Okay, so of course, in order to solve the mapping problems, one of the very important questions to ask is, what is the mapping criteria? So in other words, what does it mean by good mapping? So there are many different types of, for surface registration, there are many different types of mapping criteria. For example, geometric matching, so which is based on matching geometric quantities, for example, curvature between two surfaces. But for point cloud, it's actually kind of difficult because the computation of curvatures on point cloud is not that easy. So this is actually quite convenient to use geometric matching criteria to find mapping point cloud mapping. Another criteria is something called landmark matching criteria. So on the point cloud, you can label some features landmark on it. And then what we want to do is to match those features. For example, the facial features or sulco or dry white landmark on the brain. Okay, so this is the landmark matching based surface registration. So this is actually more suitable for point cloud mapping. So today we're going to focus on this, the landmark matching based point cloud registrations. So our goal is to look for a point cloud parameterization or registration with minimum local geometric distortion that matches the features landmark. So given those features landmark, you want to match those features landmark with minimal local geometric distortion. Okay, so in this work, so our strategy to find the least local geometric distortion mapping is to use a mapping called Teichmuller mapping. So Teichmuller mapping is the mapping that minimizes the conformality distortion, and so the local geometric distortion will be minimized subject to the landmark constraint. So this is our goal. So our contribution in this work is that we try to develop the concept of point cloud T-map. We want to formulate the definitions of T-map on point cloud, which is a discrete analog of the continuous Teichmuller mapping on point cloud, and then we want to propose an algorithm to compute the T-map. And then we call this algorithm TEMPO, which is the abbreviation of this Teichmuller extremal mapping of point cloud. Okay, so this is TEMPO for computing the Teichmuller mapping between feature and endowed point cloud. Okay, so before I can talk about this TEMPO algorithm, let me first of all give you some basic mathematical background about quasi-conformal theory. So what is a quasi-conformal mapping? So a quasi-conformal mapping is just a generalization of conformal mapping. So all of us know what is conformal mapping from complex analysis, right? So conformal mapping is a mapping that preserves angle. Okay, but a quasi-conformal mapping is just an orientation preserving homeomorphism F that sacrifices this Beltrami equation, parcel F parcel C bar equal to mu parcel F parcel C. And then when mu is equal to zero, actually you have parcel F parcel C bar equal to zero. This is actually the Cauchy-Riemann equation in complex analysis, and we know that this is conformal. Okay, and then this quantum, this complex value function mu is a very important function, which is called a Beltrami coefficient with supreme norm strictly less than one. It actually measures the local geometric distortion, it measures the conformality distortions. So intuitively, a conformal mapping will map small circle to small circle, but quasi-conformal mapping actually maps small circle to small ellipse. And then the distortion from the circle to the ellipse can actually be measured by the Beltrami coefficient. For example, the maximal squared chain can be captured by 1 plus mu, and then maximal squeezing can be captured by 1 minus mu. And then the dilation of this ellipse can be measured by 1 plus mu divided by 1 minus mu. So, yes?
So can I ask I actually worked on this a long time ago. But what I still don't understand is, you map it to a nice region, right?
Mm.
What cannot be done without the mapping?
Directly on the
3D point cloud.
Yeah, so it depends on application. For example, in computer graphics, sometimes you want to do texture mapping. So you map your surface onto the 2D image, and then you want to map it back to the original surface. So you have to do parameterization in these situations. So in other situations, for example, if you want to do meshing, for example, if you want to build a good triangulation mesh, so it is easy for us to construct some simple triangulation mesh on a simple domain instead of working on a complicated domain. So this is another application.
So it's more like do it easy, do it difficult, rather than not being able to do it at all.
Well, for meshing, I think it's really in some situations it's really unable to do it directly on the surface.
Okay.
Yeah. And also there are many other applications. Yeah. asked me this question. We have a joint paper together, actually. We have a joint paper. Okay, anyway, so so this Beltrami coefficient can actually capture a lot of geometric distortions of the quasi conformal mapping. Another important piece of information is that there is an important relationship between QC map and Beltrami coefficients. So given the quasi conformal mapping, of course I can compute the Beltrami coefficient which measure the conformality distortion. But conversely, if you give me the distortion, if you give me the Beltrami coefficients, I can reconstruct the original quasi conformal mapping. So this picture actually illustrates the idea. So for example, here we have two brain surfaces. So we compute the registration, survey registration between the two surfaces, and then we can compute the Beltrami coefficient of this mapping. And then the color map here is actually the norm of the Beltrami coefficients. And then from the Beltrami coefficient, we can actually reconstruct the original map, which is here. So you see that the mapping closely resembles, the reconstructed map closely resembles to the original mapping. So in other words, there is a one-to-one correspondence between QC mapping and Beltrami coefficient. So in order to manipulate, in order to adjust the quasi-conformal mapping, we can actually adjust the Beltrami coefficient, which is actually easier, as you're going to see later. So this is about quasi-conformal mapping on smooth manifold. But now we would like to work on point cloud. So we would like to work on point cloud. So we have to ask the question how we can formulate quasi-conformal theory on point cloud. So you see that quasi-conformal theory in continuous setting has been well studied. Okay, so on smooth manifold has been well studied, and also quasi-conformality on triangular mesh structure can be defined and computed. So conventional approach usually use the angle structure of the triangular faces. For example, the Richard flow algorithm to compute the quasi-conformal and conformal mapping use the angle structures of the triangular mesh in order to define quasi-conformality on the surface. But to the best of our knowledge, quasi-conformal on point cloud has not been studied before. It is quite challenging because there is due to the lack of angle structure. Because on point cloud, there is low connectivity information, so you cannot easily define the angle structures on the point cloud. And so it's very difficult for us to define quasi-conformalities on the point cloud structures. So our goal is to formulate quasi-conformalities on point cloud. So what we want to do is to define something called point cloud Beltrami coefficients to measure quasi-conformalities on point cloud. And we would like to study the properties of this point cloud Beltrami coefficient to see whether this quantity can really measure some geometric distortion of the local of the point cloud deformations. And we want to study the consistency of this discrete point cloud Beltrami coefficient with the continuous point cloud. Okay, so this is the complicated formula. So as I mentioned, in quasi-conformal theory, one of the most important quantity is the Beltrami coefficient, because the Beltrami coefficient tells us the local geometric distortion of the deformation or the quasi-conformality of the deformations. So in order to extend the ideas of QC onto point cloud, we define something called point cloud Beltrami coefficient, which is just a function defined on the point cloud, or the assignment of a complex number to every point of the point cloud. So this is a definition. This is our definition. So given the point cloud P, so we have the deformation. You transform the point cloud, and then let's say the deformation is given by F. U and V are the x and y coordinate of the deformations. Then you use this formula. So U, V is, I'll talk about this definition later. So U, V is the x, y coordinate of the point cloud deformations. A is some fixed matrix and Q is some fixed vector. And so by this formula, we can actually compute this point cloud Beltrami coefficient, which is just a discrete, this is just a point cloud function defined on every point of the point cloud. So in other words, you assign a complex number to every point of the point cloud. So of course you have two questions in mind, right? So first of all, how is this complicated formula defined? And secondly, even you have this point cloud function, does it really measuring something? Does it measure the local geometric distortion of your deformations? So we're going to answer these two questions. So first of all, what is the motivation for these definitions of point cloud Beltrami coefficients? So the definitions of this PCBC is actually based on the moving least square. Okay, so given a point cloud, and then given the point cloud functions, fi defined on point cloud, so the moving least square method basically trying to locally approximate at every point of the point cloud function, the moving least square trying to locally approximate the Poincaré function using a polynomial. This is based on minimizing the weighted least square problems, and the weight is equal to 1 when the point is close to the point x, and then when those points are far away from the central point x, the weight will become very, very small. So in other words, the contribution of the point far away from the center point x will be very little. And then we solve the we minimize the weighted least square energy to fit a polynomial to locally approximate the Poincaré function. And once we have this locally approximate the Poincaré function with this polynomial, usually we use a second order polynomial, we can approximate the derivative of the Poincaré function. Okay, so we call it so in our definition on a smooth manifold, a Beltrami coefficient is defined by this formula, which is partial f partial c bar divided by partial f partial c. So using the moving least square method, we can approximate this derivative, right? And then we can actually approximate this Beltrami coefficient. And then our definition here is basically just use the moving least square approximation to approximate this quantity. Okay. But now, okay, so now we have a Poincaré function defined on every point of the Poincaré. So every point of the Poincaré of the complex value has a complex number. But does this complex number tells you something? So this is our second question. So on smooth manifold, we know that the Beltrami coefficient tells us a lot of geometric information of the deformation. For example, when this Beltrami coefficient is exactly equal to 0, we know that the mapping is conformal, and then it's preserved angle. So this is angle preserving. After the deformation, the angle has to be preserved, right? But if the Beltrami coefficient is not equal to 0, then the mapping is quasi-conformal. So it will transform a circle to an ellipse, right? And then we mentioned that the dilation of the ellipse or the distortion from the circle to the ellipse can be measured by the Beltrami coefficient. So now we have a discrete version of the Beltrami coefficient, Poincaré Beltrami coefficients. So we want to ask the question whether we can also say something similar. Okay, so in the discrete situation, we want to consider the change of angle and the change of covariant matrix of the Poincaré. So if you have a Poincaré, we look at local neighborhood of the Poincaré, and after the Poincaré is transformed, deformed, you get another Poincaré. We look at their covariant matrix, and then we want to look at the change of the covariant matrix in the neighborhood. So we want to see whether this Poincaré Beltrami coefficient can really measure the change of angle and can measure the change of covariant matrix. So this is our goal. So in order to theoretically study this Poincaré Beltrami coefficient, the relationship of this Poincaré Beltrami coefficients and the distortion of the Poincaré deformations, we have to impose some assumption on the Poincaré in order to theoretically prove something. Okay, so we will impose this these two conditions, basically just impose the regularity of the Poincaré structures. So the first condition is the interior cone conditions, meaning that the domain has to satisfy this interior cone condition, means for every point in the domain, you can always find a small cone neighborhood which lies inside the domain. So this is the interior cone conditions. Another important condition for the Poincaré is the quasi-uniform conditions. So basically, a Poincaré is called quasi-uniform if the field distance is bounded by the separation distance. So the field distance is defined by these quantities. Okay, so for those of you who work on meshless numerical computation, you will know what is the field distance. The field distance is basically the radius of the smallest ball such that that would contain a point in the Poincaré. So in other words, you measure how dense the Poincaré will fill the domain. And the separation distance is basically the smallest distance between two distinct points. So a Poincaré is said to be quasi-uniform if the field distance is bounded by this separation distance. So in other words, so with this condition, you can actually show that the Poincaré will be quite regular. Okay, it will be quite regular. Okay, so if the Poincaré satisfies this condition, we can actually observe some consistency between the Poincaré Beltrami coefficient and the continuous Beltrami coefficient. Namely, the difference between the continuous, the smooth Beltrami coefficient and the discrete Beltrami coefficient is bounded by OH squared, where H squared is basically the field distance, the density of the Poincaré. So in other words, this PCBC is consistent with Poincaré in the continuous setting with an error O H squared. So And then we also, so in the smooth situation, we know that when the Beltrami coefficient is equal to zero, the mapping is conformal, and so the angle is preserved. Okay, so we want to ask the question whether this can also be measured by the discrete point cloud Beltrami coefficient. It turns out, yes, we can also show that. So under this assumption that the point cloud is quasi-uniform, we can actually show that if the Beltrami coefficient is close to zero, if the discrete point cloud Beltrami coefficient is close to zero, then the angular distortion under the point cloud deformation is also very small. So in other words, we can also use this discrete point cloud Beltrami coefficient to measure the conformality angular distortion. In particular, if the PCBC is close to zero, then the angular distortion will be small. Okay, and then if the Beltrami, so on smooth manifold, we know that when Beltrami coefficient is not equal to zero, then the distortion from the ellipse, distortion of the ellipse from the circle can be measured by the Beltrami coefficient. And actually the dilation can be measured by the Beltrami coefficient by 1 plus mu divided by 1 minus mu. So we want to ask whether this case can also be, this conclusion can also be applied to discrete point cloud Beltrami coefficient. So it turns out, yes, so suppose you have you look at a small neighborhood for the point cloud, and then under quasi conformal mapping, it's deformed the point cloud to something like an ellipse. You look at the covariant matrix of this region, and then the dilation can be captured by the ratio of the eigenvalues of the covariant matrix. And then we find that the dilation can actually, or the ratio of the eigenvalues can actually be captured by the discrete Beltrami coefficient as well. So from these three observations, we see that this discrete Beltrami, this discrete point cloud Beltrami coefficient is actually a good a measurement for the local geometric distortion of the point cloud. And this is the one of the main quantities that we use in order to develop, to define the Teichmuller mapping on point cloud and compute the Teichmuller mapping on point cloud. Okay, so this is about quasi-conformal, how to formulate quasi-conformal theory on point cloud. So now I'd like to talk about how we can define Teichmuller mapping on point cloud and how we can compute Teichmuller mapping on point cloud. So I will first of all talk about Teichmuller mapping on smooth manifold, and then I will talk about how we can define Teichmuller mapping on point cloud, and then I will talk about how we can develop an algorithm to compute this discrete Teichmuller mapping on point cloud. Okay, so first of all, let me talk about the ideas of Teichmuller mapping on smooth manifold. So what is a Teichmuller mapping? So a Teichmuller mapping is just a quasi-conformal mapping with uniform conformality distortions. So what does it mean? Okay, so suppose you have a mapping between two Riemann surfaces, S1 and S2. So this mapping is called a Teichmuller mapping associated to an integrable holomorphic function phi if the Beltrami coefficient of this mapping is in this form, where k here is a positive constant strictly less than 1, and phi here is a holomorphic function. So if you look at the norm of the Beltrami coefficient, if you look at the modulus of this Beltrami coefficient, you see that the norm is the constant, it's equal to k. So in other words, okay, a Teichmuller mapping or a T-map is a quasi-conformal mapping with constant conformality distortion. So here is one of the illustrations of a T-map. Okay, so suppose you have a circle. Okay, on the circle you draw some circle patterns on it, and then you try to deform the circle to find a quasi-conformal mapping from the unit disk to the unit disk, which is quasi-conformal, which is a general quasi-conformal mapping. Then you see that the infinitesimal circles will be mapped to infinitesimal ellipse because this is quasi-conformal with different conformality distortion. So we can see that the dilation of the ellipse are different over the different domain. And actually, if you plot the histogram of the Beltrami histogram of the norm of the Beltrami coefficient, so you see that the histogram is kind of scattered, meaning that the conformality distortion is not uniform over the whole domain. Okay, but if you try to use the T-map to transform the disk, then you see that the infinitesimal circle will be mapped to infinitesimal ellipse with similar eccentricity, with similar dilation. So if you plot the histogram of the norm of the Beltrami coefficient, you see that the the norm is accumulated at some point, meaning that the conformality distortion is uniform everywhere. So this is the message, okay? So what is the T-map? T-map is just a QC mapping with uniform conformality distortion. This is the take-home message. Okay. So
what's the phi bar?
Phi bar is a holomorphic function. It's just a holomorphic function. So it basically tells us, so phi bar divided by the norm of phi basically tells us the argument, the angle of the Beltrami coefficient. Because the Beltrami coefficient is a complex value function. So you have the modulus, which is the length of the complex number, and also you have the angle of the complex number. And this phi basically tells phi bar divided by the norm of phi basically tells the angle of the Beltrami coefficient. So this is, and this is, and this phi has to be holomorphic. This is very important. And this is the reason why in our algorithm that you're going to see later, we have to do something in order to make sure that the argument part comes from a holomorphic function. Okay. So closely related to this T-map is something called extremal mapping. So okay, what is extremal mapping? So extremal mapping is a crossly conformal mapping that minimizes the conformality distortions. So in other words, so more formal definitions of extremal map is that subject to a boundary constraint, an extremal map is the mapping that minimizes the Beltrami coefficient in the L infinity sense. Okay, so this is extremal map. So in other words, extremal map is the quasi-conformal mapping that minimizes the Beltrami coefficient in L infinity sense subject to the boundary constraint. If you do not enforce any boundary constraint, of course the minimum will be the conformal one, because mu is equal to zero must be the most conformal mapping. But in practical situation, we always have to enforce constraints. For example, if you want to map two faces, then of course I have to enforce my left eye to be mapped to Raymond left eye, my right eye have to map to Raymond right eye, right? If my left eye maps to Raymond nose, right, then the comparison will be inaccurate. Okay, so we always have to enforce some constraint. And then with this constraint, then conformal mapping may not exist. So the question is whether we can find the extremal mapping that minimizes the conformality distortion in the L infinity sense. And this extremal mapping is called a Euler extremal if the inequality here is Euler, is strict. So in other words, there is only one extremal mapping. Mm-hmm. Okay, so properties of extremal map minimizes conformality distortion, and so the local geometry distortion is minimized. So we can actually, in pure mathematics, quasi conformal theory has already shown that extremal mapping always exists, but in some but this may not be Euler. So in some, so depends on boundary condition. But under suitable condition on the boundary and Lamarck constraint, this extremal mapping is Euler. Okay, so this is a good thing. So if you enforce some good condition on the boundary, then this extremal mapping is Euler. And more important thing is that there is a very, very important relationship between P-map and extremal mapping. Okay, under suitable boundary conditions, a Teichmuller mapping is actually the extremal mapping for open surfaces. Okay, so here I say this, but actually this topology, if you have a surface with this topology, then this theorem also applies, because you can actually map everything on the Euler disk, and then this theorem actually apply. So suppose you are given a boundary conditions, a boundary mapping, so and then from the Euler disk to the Euler disk. And then you want to find a mapping between two Euler disks. Okay, so if you look at if you have a boundary mapping from a circle to a circle, and then you want to extend the mapping to this mapping subject to this boundary conditions. Okay, so suppose this boundary condition satisfies this condition. The first derivative is not equal to zero, and the second derivative is bounded on the boundary. Then that is the Teichmuller mapping F. That is the Euler extremal extension of H to the whole Euler disk. So in other words, this theorem tells us that the following. Okay, for open surfaces with this topology, if the boundary correspondence satisfies a good condition for the derivative, first derivative is not equal to zero, second derivative is bounded, then the extremal mapping is exactly equal to the Teichmuller mapping. So in other words, if you want to compute the T-map, you can actually compute extremal mapping. If you want to find a mapping that minimizes the conformality distortion, you can actually look for the T-map. Okay, so this is the message. Okay, so this is the theorem which imposed the boundary conditions of the mapping. So, and then this theorem can actually be extended to the situation where the interior Lamarck constraint is enforced. So for, suppose we have two surfaces, S1 and S2, you are given the boundary conditions, and also you try to impose some interior landmark conditions. For example, in the interior of your surface, you have some feature landmark, and then you want to enforce the feature landmark correspondence between two surfaces. Then we can also show that there exists a Teichmuller mapping, a landmark matching Teichmuller mapping between the two surfaces, which is a unique extremal mapping. So in other words, in this situation, if you are given the boundary conditions, okay, of two open surfaces like my face and Raymond face, okay, if our boundary condition is good enough, okay, first derivative is not equal to zero, second derivative is bounded, and then I impose some interior landmark constraint. My left eye has to map to his left eye, and right eye map to his right eyes, and so on. Then I can always find a Teichmuller mapping between my face and Raymond face, which is the extremal mapping, which is the extreme the unit extremal mapping that minimizes the local geometric distortions. Okay, so the main idea here is that if the boundary satisfies a certain condition, there exists landmark matching T map, and then this T map is unit extremal mapping. So given the prescribed set of landmark constraints, associated T-map is unique. And by definition, the T-map has Beltrami coefficient with constant norm k strictly less than 1. So this T-map must be a bijective mapping. So we can always find a bijective mapping. Okay. So in other words, to summarize, the computation of T-map or the computation of Teichmuller extremal mapping involves solving the following optimization problems. So we want to minimize the Beltrami coefficient of a mapping in the L infinity sense, subject to the constraint that the boundary condition is equal to the prescribed boundary conditions, and then FPJ is equal to QJ, which is the landmark constraint, interior landmark constraint. So in other words, we want to look for all mapping that satisfies the boundary condition and interior landmark constraint while minimizing the L infinity norm of the Beltrami coefficients. Okay, so this is extremal. This is basically the mathematical formulations of the extremal mapping. But equivalently, so finding the extremal mapping is equivalent to finding the Teichmuller mapping, because we say that under suitable conditions, T map is actually the extremal mapping. So in other words, what we need to do is to find a T map that satisfies this Beltrami equation, because T map is just a quasi-conformal mapping with whose Beltrami coefficient is in this form. So we want to solve the Beltrami equation, partial f, partial c bar equal to some Beltrami coefficient multiplied by partial f, partial c, and the Beltrami coefficient must be in this form, k phi bar divided by the norm of phi. Okay, so subject to the boundary constraint and interior landmark constraint. So solving this PDE is also not easy, you bring a bar, because f is unknown, the parameter k is unknown, and the holomorphic function phi here is also unknown. So basically, we know that there exists such a mapping f and such a quantity k and such a holomorphic function phi that satisfies this equation. But we don't know what is k, we don't know what is phi, and we don't know what is f. So solving this equation is also not easy. So in pure mathematics, mathematician has always shown the existence of the solution of this Beltrami equation. But the proof is basically not constructive. So in other words, you cannot use the proof to compute the Teichmuller the T map. Okay. So two years ago, we tried to develop an algorithm, an iterative algorithm to compute this T map. So if you look at the definitions of T map, so you can actually see that the definition of T-map is that it is the quasi-conformal mapping with uniform conformality distortion. The norm of the Beltrami coefficient must be a constant, and then the argument of the Beltrami coefficient must come from a holomorphic function. Okay, so what we try to do is that we develop an iterative scheme which iteratively modify the Beltrami coefficient. So in each iteration, you have a mapping which may not be a T-map. So in other words, this is not a mapping whose Beltrami coefficient may not be of constant norm. So in each iteration, what we do is, first of all, we normalize the norm of the Beltrami coefficients, and then in the argument part, we do a Laplacian smoothing on the argument part. And then upon convergence, then we can show that the norm must be a constant norm, and then the argument part must come from the holomorphic function, because you basically Laplacian smoothing right? At a point convergence, then you have Laplacian equals zero, then you have a harmonic function, and then you can find a harmonic conjugate, and then basically you can get a holomorphic function. So we use this idea to iteratively modify the Beltrami coefficient to compute the T-map. Okay, so the idea seems to be very simple, and then in experiment, we always can find a mapping that's converged to the T-map. So theoretically, we can also show this algorithm can actually converge to the T-map. So our algorithm is actually very simple. What you need to do is just a Laplace smoothing of the Beltrami coefficient and then the normalization of the norm of the Beltrami coefficient. It turns out that this iterative scheme is basically the minimization of a generalized harmonic energy under some distorted metric given by the Beltrami coefficients. So basically, if you look at the space of all Beltrami coefficients of Teichmuller type, so of this type, then you can define energy on this space using this formula, which is the minimum of the harmonic energy respect to some distorted matrix given by mu, so which is given by this formula. We can actually show that this energy, this generalized harmonic energy, is a convex energy, and this global minimizer is the Teichmuller extremal map. Okay, and then we can actually show that the QC iterations is nothing but just to minimize this convex energy. So this is the idea. Okay, and then the proof is a little bit lengthy, but you can actually look at the proof in this paper, which is published in Mathematics of Computations. Okay, so this is about T-map on smooth manifold. So now we want to talk about how we can define T-map on point cloud. So motivated by the definitions of T-map on smooth manifold, we want to define the T-map such that the point cloud Beltrami coefficient has constant norm, first of all. And also we want to define something which is similar to the definition that the argument of the point cloud Beltrami coefficient comes from the holomorphic function. Okay. So the first, so this is our definitions. So suppose you have a point cloud, and then suppose we have a mapping F, okay, which is a point cloud deformations. We say that this point cloud deformation is a T-map, it's a PC T-map, if it has a constant norm everywhere for every point of the point cloud. And secondly, the Laplacians of the Beltrami coefficient multiplied by the conjugate of the Beltrami coefficient is a real number. Okay, so this definition seems to be a little bit complicated, but actually we can show that this definition is consistent, is actually equivalent to the definition that the argument of the Beltrami coefficient comes from the holomorphic function. But using this definition is actually better because defining holomorphic function on the point cloud is very difficult. So it's very difficult to define what is holomorphic on the point cloud. But defining Laplace Beltrami operators on the point cloud is not difficult because we have a lot of matchless numerical algorithms. So this motivates to use this definition in our definition of point cloud theorem. And then we can actually show that under suitable conditions, which is quasi-uniform and interior cone condition, we can show that the PC T-map converges to the continuous T-map as the field distance tends to zero. So as the point cloud becomes denser and denser, we can actually show that the discrete point cloud T-map actually converges to the continuous T-map. So we see that there is a consistency between discrete and continuous. Okay, so now we can actually So now I'm going to talk about how we can compute this Teichmuller point cloud mapping. So first of all, I will talk about how we can compute the Teichmuller point cloud parameterizations. So what do we want to do? So what we want to do is, okay, suppose we have a surface, okay? So we want to parameterize the surface onto some simple domain such that the landmark, the feature landmark labeled on the surface will be mapped to some fixed location on the 2D domain. So for example, for texture mapping, right? So if I want to map an image onto my face, right? Then of course I want to make sure that my eyes are mapped to the eyes of on the image. So we have to fix the location of the landmark. So we want to compute a parameterization that deforms the surface onto the 2D domain, such that the landmark will be mapped to some fixed locations. Okay. So what we're trying to do is we first of all conformally parameterize the point cloud, okay, onto a 2D domain to simplify the problems. So if you do the conform parameterization, this landmark may not be mapped to your target location. So what we need to do is, the most important step is, we need to compute a Teichmuller mapping between these two domains that align the landmark consistently. So this is where we need to compute the Teichmuller mapping. Okay, so how can we compute the Teichmuller mapping? So motivated by the QC iteration that we mentioned before, so what we need to do is to iteratively modify the Beltrami coefficient. the Beltrami coefficient of a T-map must have constant norm. So what we need to do is that in each iteration, we modify the Beltrami coefficient by normalizing the norm of the Beltrami coefficients, and then we do a Laplace moving of the Beltrami coefficient. Then with this new Beltrami coefficient, we reconstruct the quasi-conform mapping with respect to this new Beltrami coefficient, and then we keep the iteration going, okay, and then we keep the iteration going, okay? So how do we, okay, more specifically, how do we modify the Beltrami coefficient? So to modify the Beltrami coefficient, basically it's very simple. We just need to modify the modulus of the Beltrami coefficient and the argument part of the Beltrami coefficient. Okay, so for the modulus part, basically, we just normalize, okay? We look at the average of the norm of the Beltrami coefficient over the whole point cloud, and then we normalize the norm of the Beltrami coefficient. And then for the argument part, we just do a Laplace moving. We do a Laplace moving of the argument part of the Beltrami coefficient. And then we get a new Beltrami coefficient, compute quasi-conform mapping, and then go back and iterate. Okay, so this is very similar to the QC iteration in the smooth situations. And it turns out that we can actually show that, again, under suitable condition, again, the point cloud must be quasi-uniform with a sample from a domain that satisfies the interior cone conditions. We can actually show that this iterative scheme will converge to the point cloud T-map. And actually, the point cloud T-map will converge to the continuous T-map as field distance goes to zero. So you see that this definition is a reasonable definition of point cloud T-map on point cloud. Okay, so we can also apply this idea to our point cloud registration. So suppose you have two surfaces, two 3D surfaces. So if I want to map my phase to Riemann phase, so what I can do is that we can first of all conformally parameterize Riemann phase to a 2D domain. Okay, so then the features of Riemann phase will be mapped on the 2D domain. Then in order to compute MR matching registration from my phase to Riemann phase, what I need to do is to compute a Teichmuller point cloud quantization onto the 2D domain, such that my landmark will be mapped to Riemann landmark on the 2D domain. And then the composition mapping will be the landmark matching cloud registration between the two surfaces. So this is how we do. Okay. So another important piece of information is that T-map actually gives rise to a very, very important matrix to do shape classification. Okay, 5 minutes. Okay. So basically, if I have two landmark feature-endowed point cloud surfaces, if I want to compare, if I want to find out the distance between my phase to Riemann phase, so I will need to define some matrix, some distance. Okay. So actually, in quasi-conformal Teichmuller theory, we actually have a matrix, something called Teichmuller matrix, which is obtained by minimizing this energy functional, which basically minimize the dilations of all the landmark matching mapping between the two surfaces. So what we need to do is to minimize this dilation. Okay, then dilation is given by this quantity. Okay, so minimizing this problem is not easy, but it turns out that the minimizer, we can show that the minimizer for this mapping is actually the T-map. So in other words, in order to compute this Teichmuller distance, what we need to do is to compute a T-map. And once we compute the T-map, and then we can use the norm of the Beltrami coefficient of the T-map to compute this Teichmuller matrix, and then we can compute the Teichmuller distance. Okay, so I will skip this. Let me show some application. Let me show some result. Okay, so I have 4 minutes. Okay. So here is some of the experimental results. So we have a complicated point cloud surface, and on the point cloud, I label four landmarks on it. And then I first of all compute the conformal quantization of this surface, and then the landmark are mapped to this green dot. Okay, but let's say I don't actually want the landmark to be mapped to this location. I actually want the landmark to be mapped to this location. Then we use the Teichmuller quantization, Teichmuller mapping, to align this landmark. Okay, and then I compute the alignment. Okay, and then this is the histogram of the point cloud Beltrami coefficient. You see that the norm of the PCBC actually accumulated at 0.2, meaning that this is actually a point cloud T-map. So this is another example. So you have a denser map, and then we also get a PC T-map. And then phase, we also get a PC T-map. Okay, this is the computation time. So you see that the computation is not too slow, so usually it takes around a few minutes, even for 100,000 points, it takes around 2.5 minutes to compute. And then if you look at the variant of the Bertrami coefficient, it's quite small. Because actually you want the variant to be small because you want the law of the Bertrami coefficient to be constant. So you want the law to be small. So you see that as the numbers of points increases, then the variant will actually decrease. So it's getting better, and the result will get better and better. Okay, and this is the result for Teichmuller point cloud registration. My phase, Raymond phase, we compute a conformed quantization, compute the Teichmuller matching between the two domains, and then we can, using this composition mapping, I can deform my phase to Raymond phase, and then we can get a registration between two phases. Okay, so we can also use the Teichmuller distance matrix, Teichmuller matrix, to do some shape classifications. So here, for each row, we have one person, okay, with different expressions. Okay, we want to classify. These are four phases. We just use the k-mean clustering to do the classifications, and then we compare a state-of-the-art algorithm for a feature-endowed point cloud shape analysis algorithm. Basically, it uses the iterative closest point algorithm to try to find a matching and then define a distance, and then the classification accuracy of this state-of-the-art algorithm is 50%, and ours is actually much better, it's 94%. And then we test it on a much larger data set. And this is the partial list of the phases. And again, each row actually show one person with different expressions. And then we consider a very, very big data set. And then we also do some classification. And then again, okay, so just happen the classification accuracy for this state-of-the-art algorithm is 50%, and our algorithm is 79%. Again, the classification method that we use is very, very primitive. We just use k-mean clustering. So we think if we use more sophisticated, more advanced classification algorithm, we get much better classification result. Okay, so some more applications, so meshing. So Wu-Tao asked the questions. So if you're a point cloud, if you map it to a simple domain, then on the simple domain, you can do triple Dirac triangulation, or you can build a triangulation for the triple domain, and then map it back to the original surface, and then you can do the meshing. But you cannot see the mesh here. So this one is better. So you parameterize onto the sphere, and then you do triple Dirac on it, and then you can project the triangulation back to the original point cloud, and then you get the meshing. You can also build a cord mesh or whatever for point cloud. The good thing about it is actually topologically preserving, because you ensure that the point cloud must be mapped to a sphere, and then you build a triangulation here and then map it back. Then it's topologically preserving. Okay, and this is some real data, okay, requested by reviewer. So they asked us to do some experiment on real data, and then we can also do the survey reconstruction by parameterization. Okay, so with that, I'm going to stop here. Thank you.
So I'm not sure I understood how to deal with possible loop layers like in the last slide. How sensitive is this process to variations, local variations?
Yeah. To
if your point cloud is not exactly on your surface, what?
Oh, like this, right?
Like this, for
instance. So depends. If you do not enforce any landmark, okay. So depends. Okay, for example, in this situation, you enforce very few landmark, then the Bertrami coefficient is small. Then in this situation, it's quite stable. But if you enforce a lot of landmark, then the Bertrami coefficient becomes larger. Then in that situation, the algorithm may be a little bit unstable. And in that situation, we have to do some point cloud smoothing before we can apply the algorithm. Yeah, this is actually one of the drawbacks of the algorithm so far. But for example, in this example, we just want to do the meshing. So we just want to compute a conformal quantization, right? So in this situation, it's quite stable. So for example, here we just we didn't do any smoothing. We just conformally parameterize onto the sphere, and then we build a triangulation mesh on the sphere, interpolate back to the original surface. And this is something that we can. Okay. So if you do not enforce too much constraint, then it's quite stable.
Speaking of the smoothing, could you actually use the conformal map to smooth the point cloud in this space in an effective way and then map it back? If it's too noisy, is that actually, can you use the conformal map?
Yeah, this is example.
That's actually
this example you can see exactly. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, this example, that's interesting, yeah. But we haven't shown, we don't have a proof, but in all our experiment, we find that if you have a noisy point cloud, you do a circle conform quantization onto the unit sphere, and then you construct a triangulation mesh on the sphere and interpolate back to the original surface, it's quite smooth.
How do you spoof? We
don't do the smoothing. This is basically what we got.
Yeah. But if you would do it, would you have an idea of what would be a good way?
Point cloud smoothing. I'm from UCLA, right? So one of the things is the level set method, right? So you have a point cloud and then you use a level set.
Sorry, I mean it's conformal. If you could map it and then smooth it there and map it back.
Oh, one of the ways is that once you have the coordinate. So one, for example, if you're a point cloud and then you map it to the sphere, then you have the on the basically you have a function, right, on the sphere. So on the sphere you have an x coordinate, y coordinate, z coordinate on the sphere. Then you can do a smoothing on this x, y, z coordinate. Yeah.
I guess I'll ask you again.
So at the very beginning, when you assign the Bertramian coefficient to the value,
right,
you somehow try to figure out through local least squares, figure out the neighboring information in some
sense.
Right. Is that right?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's not useful in some sense.
Yeah.
We know.
So the weighting function is important, actually. Yeah. The weighting, this is actually a good point here. The weighting here is actually very important. So how do you choose the weighting is very important. So for very, very noisy point clouds, then you have to choose a good weighting. But I guess this is always the difficulty for meshless numerical computation.
Can we take a photo together, just in case some people escape from the room? So do it in the front or somewhere. Take a photo.
Remember you talked something about this before.